Good morning, Fullwood. Please stand. We'll start with a prayer. Lord God, we come into your presence, Father, to worship you. And we believe, we choose to believe that the battle has already been fought and you've won it. It may not feel like it sometimes, Lord, but we believe that you have won on our behalf and you represent us. And one day we'll be with you. Lord, we praise you in your name. Amen.
Nothing can stand against the power of our God. Now all I know, your voice.
thank you for the cross.
Thank you for the price you paid, buried all my sin and shame. In love you came and gave amazing grace. Thank you for this blood, Lord. Thank you for the helpless eyes.
Wash me. Seated on the throne, crown you now with many crowns. You reign victorious. You are high and lifted up. Jesus, Son of God, the darling of heaven crucified. Worthy is the Lamb. Worthy is the Lamb.
If you've got an ear to hear this morning, you might be able to hear the voices singing in heaven. Worthy is the Lamb, it says in the book of Revelation. As we join here on earth, that we have an open heaven this morning. And we join with the saints going down through generations upon generations, singing, holy, 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 worthy is the Lamb. And I just want you just to continue in your hearts, just to keep worshiping. I'm going to ask the band if they just sing the chorus and the high and lifted up just one more time. And I want you, this is your moment. We gather together as the Fullwood family once a week, a corporate worship, the call to worship the one that's worthy of worship. He's worthy of worship because he's good. And he's worthy of worship because he's great. And he's worthy of worship because he showered grace upon our lives. And I want you to focus on the most important relationship in your life. Because as you do, church, all the challenges of our life start to get perspective when we put him into the proper perspective. And as we just sing this chorus one more time, I want you, with everything that's within you, to lift up your voice and give him worth and worship that's due his name. in 1 Chronicles chapter 16, it reads, "Give thanks to the Lord." Why? "For he is good. His love endures forever." Heavenly Father, this morning, as your children here at Fullwood, we embrace your love. We thank you that you've crowned our heads with loving kindness and tender mercy, and that you're not just a shepherd, but you're a good shepherd. And you know what you're doing with our lives, and you lead us beside green pastures and still waters. And this morning, as a corporate body, we give you praise and we give you worship, for you are good and for you are great. We thank you for Jesus. We thank you for the cross. We thank you for forgiveness. We thank you that you've translated us out of darkness and into light, and you've placed us as part of your family, as the children of God. Holy Spirit, even now, I ask that you come and do that unique work that only you can do, of comforting, convicting, healing, restoring, and bringing the illumination to your word that only you can do. In Jesus' name, amen. Please take your seats. Well, I want to give everyone a big welcome here to the Fullwood family. And if it's your first time, we want to give you a very special welcome this morning. For our congregation online, I trust that you sense the presence of God as we do here. Please place a comment. You know, thumbs up or a big love heart, place a comment. Don't argue with the bishop when she's speaking this morning. But we trust that you'll be touched by God's word and God's presence with us as we meet. Isn't it wonderful to just sing the praises of God as the family of God as we meet here this morning? Well, if you can just place your eyes on the screen, there's a video that's just about to be played.
The Bible course is an accessible way for anyone to explore the world's bestseller. Because the Bible is a big book, it can be hard to know where to start. So the Bible course gives the big picture, showing how all of the events, books, and characters fit together to form one incredible story. Whether you are new to the Christian faith or just want to find out more, the Bible course is for you. Filmed on location and in a purpose-built studio, the Bible course consists of 8 interactive sessions through the whole Bible story, from the first book, Genesis, to the last book, Revelation. Each session combines video teaching, group discussion, personal reflection, and daily readings. Bring God's word to life by running the Bible course in your setting.
Well, let me encourage you to take a look at this course and to sign up. You can sign up on all the normal places. We've got a link on church, our church life. We've got a link online, and you can also sign up hard copy on the welcome desk. We've already got 27 people signed up, but there's still plenty of spaces. So this course will give you a really great handle on the greatest book ever written, the book that impacts billions of people's lives, and the book that has impacted our society here. So it's starting on the 17th of April at 7:30, so get yourself signed up, and I know that that will be a tremendous blessing in your life. Well, this morning we have 2 bishops in the house that we have the privilege of welcoming. So Bishop Tony and Lucille, his wife, we give you a fantastic welcome. Tony's become a great friend. And we've also got another great friend, Bishop Jill, this morning with us. And she's going to be bringing the Word of God in just a moment. But Bishop Jill is the Bishop of Lancaster. And we've already put out Jill's bio already, and we've spoken about it in the previous weeks. So there's so much, I won't communicate it all here. But there are a couple of things that I want to highlight as a church here that we've really appreciated. We have head teachers in the church here, and they have personally come to me and spoken to me about the influence and leadership that they've appreciated from Bishop Jill, especially in the educational sector within the C of E schools. And Sarah and I, who are parents, and we know what it is to have a school that our kids go to that doesn't have that strong Christian ethos. So we've appreciated Bishop Jill's influence in that area, and also in the area of chaplains. So we have chaplains here in this church also, and in the areas of the NHS and education and hospices, they have told me personally, once again, the tremendous encouragement that Bishop Jill has given them. Myself, some of our pastors here, and other people I know in both services have also enjoyed the ministry over the years of new wine. And the leading of the Spirit that that particular network has given. And so, once again, we appreciate Bishop Jill, who is the chair of the board there for New Wine and bringing direction and spiritual input. But for myself personally, many of us, including myself, has been praying for Jill last year, 2023, as she navigated the ups and downs in the process of living in love and faith within the Church of England. We appreciated her strong stand for historic and biblical Christian marriage and sexual ethics. Her wisdom, her calm balance, and her compassion was recognized during pressurized times last year. And as a church, we've been praying for her, and we've really appreciated her. Let's give Bishop Jill a forward warm welcome. Louise, if you can give us the reading from God's word this morning.
Thank you. Good morning, everyone. This morning's reading comes from Matthew chapter 9, verses 35 through to chapter 10, verse 20. It begins with "The workers are few." Jesus went through all the towns and villages, teaching in their synagogues, proclaiming the good news of the kingdom and healing every disease and sickness. When he saw the crowds, he had compassion on them because they were harassed and helpless, like sheep without a shepherd. Then he said to his disciples, "The harvest is plentiful, but the workers are few. Ask the Lord of the harvest, therefore, to send out workers into his harvest field." Reading from chapter 10, where Jesus sends out the 12. Jesus called his 12 disciples to him and gave them authority to drive out impure spirits and to heal every disease and sickness. These are the names of the 12 apostles. First, Simon, who is called Peter, and his brother Andrew. James, son of Zebedee, and his brother John. Philip and Bartholomew. Thomas and Matthew the tax collector. James, son of Alphaeus and Thaddeus. Simon the zealot, and Judas Iscariot, who betrayed him. These 12 Jesus sent out with the following instructions. "Do not go among the Gentiles or enter any town of the Samaritans. Go rather to the lost sheep of Israel. As you go, proclaim this message: the kingdom of heaven has come near. Heal the sick, raise the dead, cleanse those who have leprosy, drive out demons. Freely you have received, freely give. Do not get any gold or silver or copper to take with you in your belts, no bag for the journey or extra shirt or sandals or a staff, for the worker is worth his keep. Whatever town or village you enter, search there for some worthy person and stay at their house until you leave. As you enter the home, give it your greeting. If the home is deserving, let your peace rest on it. If it is not, let your peace return to you. If anyone will not welcome you or listen to your words, leave that home or town and shake the dust off your feet. Truly I tell you, it will be more bearable for Sodom and Gomorrah on the day of judgment than for that town. I am sending you out like sheep among wolves. Therefore, be as shrewd as snakes and as innocent as doves. Be on your guard. You will be handed over to the local councils and be flogged in the synagogues. On my account, you will be brought before governors and kings as witnesses to them and to the Gentiles. But when they arrest you, do not worry about what to say or how to say it. At that time, you will be given what to say, for it will not be you speaking, but the Spirit of your Father speaking through you. Amen.
Well, thank you so much, Ian, and thank you, Sarah, for your welcome. I've never had such a great runway before speaking before, so you're getting top marks here at Fullwood this morning. Just as a way into our passage, I want to imagine you're suddenly taken to a desert island, okay, and you're only allowed to take one verse or a few verses of scripture with you. What would you take? So you're not in Preston. You're on a desert island. You're only allowed a few verses of scripture. What would you take? Have a think. Now, interestingly, I think often the scripture that we reach for is very connected to our vocation, to our calling. And this is my life scripture, so to speak. And so I thought I'd choose it to speak to you today. But I have like prayed and agonized for you from a distance, really. So it's been lovely to be invited here today, and I feel very much as that Free Methodists, you carry something of the same fire that John Wesley carried, that meant unfortunately my ancestors kind of pushed you out of the Church of England. But we need to be on your coattails. We need to be catching up with you. So I come to honor you in that sense. I think John Wesley was once asked, why was it he managed to, gather these, amazing crowds, around this part of the world as well. And he said this, I set myself on fire and people come to watch me burn. And I was, as we were praying before the start of today, I don't normally come to churches where they have a massive gathering of people to pray. I think that says something about you as a church family. But the image I had was, I was reminded of that story from 2 Kings 6 when Elisha's servant is afraid. He's afraid of what's happening in the natural, on the horizontal. And Elisha says, open his eyes. Lord, would you open his eyes? And he sees the horses and chariots of fire on the hills all around. So often we see just in one dimension, we see in a horizontal dimension. That's what the Pope calls it. We see horizontally, but we need to be seeing vertically. And I want to encourage you by what I see around you and what I encounter here in terms of the presence of God, in terms of that open heaven, which Ian spoke about. That is really special, and I'm honoured to be here. So as we look at scripture together, let's pray. Would you come down, O most powerful Holy Spirit, and subdue us? From heaven, where the ordinary is made glorious and glory is but ordinary. Would you open our eyes to see the wonderful truths in your word? And would you bathe us with the brilliance of your light, like dew? Amen. So I've got my life passage here today, and I've got 3 points. God's heart's breaking, God's heart surgery, and God's heart for Fullwood. I'll take those in turn. But in particular, this is the verse 36 of chapter 9. When Jesus saw the crowds, he had compassion on them because they were harassed and helpless like sheep without a shepherd. And he said to his disciples, the harvest is plentiful, but the workers are few. So when Jesus saw the crowds, he had compassion on them. In English, that's quite a soft word, isn't it? Compassion, there, have a cup of tea. But in the original Greek, and I know this, my husband's a bit of a Greek scholar. In fact, often when I go to places, people say, oh, you're married to Jeremy Duff, because he wrote this kind of Greek textbook. But in the Greek, it says, the word we use compassion here means his guts were twisted. There was an agony. There was pain in his heart. And it's the same word we get in Luke 15, in the parable of the prodigal son, when the father sees a son on the horizon, and he coming home, it says he was filled with compassion, and he ran to meet his son. And that's why we need scripture, because God is not like we think he is. We can easily think that God is in judgment on our nation. But actually, what Jesus says is God is missing his lost sons and daughters with the same agony as if a father's lost his son. And I hope that's not been a real story for you. I mean, I've got two sons and I have big teenagers, but when the younger one was three, we lost him for 20 minutes at this big cathedral do. And that was the longest 20 minutes of my life of wondering what happened to Harry. But that's the agony in the heart of God for the people of Fulwood, for people in your workplace, people in your school, people across Preston. It's an agony of a father who's missing his son. And I think that agony is so intense, it's forcing its way into our culture. Have you noticed how this sort of message of home or come home is so strong in our culture? So Star Wars 7, if you've watched that, there's a really heart-wrenching moment at the end of the film when Han Solo meets his estranged son, Kylo Ren, and he says to him, "We miss you. Please come home." Or if you've watched Paddington 2, I can't watch the end of Paddington 2 without crying. Now, why is that? At the end of Paddington 2, he wakes up in bed, he's had all these adventures, and then he realizes it's Aunt Lucy's birthday and he hasn't got her a present. And Mrs. Brown says, "Don't worry, come downstairs." And in the hall, he bumps into all the people he's accidentally helped during the course of the film. And then the doorbell goes. He opens it. It's Aunt Lucy. He couldn't get his present to Peru, so they brought Aunt Lucy to London. And I think the reason I find that such a tearful moment is because I think it's a picture of the reality of heaven, literally, is that we'll bump into lots of people we accidentally helped, and then we'll meet Jesus face to face. And I think that longing in our hearts is so strong. That's why that film sells. That's what Hollywood do. They make money out of the reality of heaven. That also happens in our advertising. Have you noticed IKEA? They will sell you a happier life at home. That's one of their strap lines. If you can manage to put together the furniture, which I can never do, but you know, if you get past that stress. Or Rightmove, they will sell you a forever home. Why are these messages so potent in our culture? It's because that they speak to our hearts that are made for our Father in heaven. And we remember this time of year that Jesus has gone ahead to prepare that place for us, hasn't he? Notice in this fiery love that God has for his sons and daughters, notice how an encounter with him is always preceded by peace. This comes in the passage, but it also comes a lot through scripture. This is verse 12. "As you enter a home, give it your greeting. If a home is deserving, let your peace rest upon it. If it's not, let your peace return to you." And my experience of sharing the gospel is that there's just sometimes moments when it's easy to share, and moments or people when it's not. So I've worked in a company when occasionally there's massive wide open doors, talking about Jesus, and then other times you feel like a complete idiot. But actually, it's often when the peace of God precedes. And just note for this, and I've taken myself to praying for it literally in conversations. So I was with my son plays rugby, normally on a Sunday morning, and we were with one of the dads in the bar afterwards, and he was giving me all this sort of, all the things that were wrong with the Church of England. That's quite an easy thing to talk about, isn't it? So I was kind of on my back foot here. And so I found myself praying, "Lord, would you bring your peace? Would you bring your peace?" And suddenly the conversation switched. And he said, "Do you know what? This really funny thing happened. A friend of mine had this cancer diagnosis before Christmas. And she went to this weird church, this Methodist church. Have you heard of them?" she said. and they were really praying for her. And then after Christmas, she went for a scan. There wasn't anything there. This is a guy who's very senior. He's kind of in the media almost. Very senior. In some ways, he's got it all made. there's a, you know, got it all sorted. And yeah, he was reaching out. But sort of peace shifted in that conversation. Another example is where I used to live in Widnes. So before this, I've been Bishop of Lancaster for 6 years. Before now, I used to live in Widnes. And our vicarage was right in the middle of the town square of Widnes. Widnes is a place that people go past rather than go to. See, I'm not expecting you to know it. But it used to be a beautiful Victorian town square. In the 70s, they sold the town hall and it became a nightclub. And so we were surrounded by 8 nightclubs, all with 5 o'clock in the morning licenses. So it was quite noisy on a Friday or Saturday night. But the plus was, it was surrounded by amazing takeaways. Okay. So, Friday nights, it's February, it was dark, going for my takeaway, just across, literally, as the distance of the church. And I bump into these 3 girls, and they're teenagers, 12, 13. I thought, gosh, what are you doing out at night? This, you know, they said, well, Chloe's been kicked out of school, mum's at bingo. I thought, oh, well, what can I do for you? I said, well, can I pray for you that Chloe will get back into school? Okay. So I prayed. I prayed for Chloe to get back into school, and I prayed for this passage for the peace of God to come down. When I finished praying, I looked up, and their heads were like meerkats. There was a change in the atmosphere that happened. And they said, well, where do you live? I said, well, I just live in that vicarage there, and we have this service on a Sunday afternoon. Who wants to come to it all age, you know? I thought I'd never hear anything about it. Next Sunday, I was in the... because I was the vicar's wife at that point, I was doing the children's work, and the children's work was not my strong suit. And we were a much smaller church than you. We had, in a little side room off church, we had about 5 or 6 kids between 5 and 11 on these different emergency chairs. And we were doing this story about Jesus and the blind man Bartimaeus, you know, when he says, what do you want me to do for you? And these girls then march in. Oh, no, it's so age inappropriate. I said, well, we're doing this story and we're drawing pictures of what you want Jesus to do for you. And so the first one, like, flicked her hair and got a pen and said, I want Jesus to give me £1.20. And the next one, like, mutinied and copied too. I want Jesus to give me £1.20. And the third one, same, I want Jesus to give me £1.20. And then they kind of flicked their hair together and they kind of walked off. And I felt that sense of shame of, like, what an opportunity missed for church and Jesus. That night, they were walking along the street in Widnes. A tramp crossed the road, shoved some money in their hand, £3.60. Came back to church the next week. Chloe got back into school. She brought a boyfriend. A boyfriend said, huh, this is so boring. And Chloe said, well, she prays and stuff happens. Glory to Jesus. The peace of Jesus. So always pray for the peace of Jesus and carry. Because that's the atmosphere of heaven, and carry his heart. Second point is God's heart surgery. This is verse 8. Jesus says, the kingdom, this is his message to preach, the kingdom of God, heaven has come near. Heal those who are sick, raise the dead, cleanse those with leprosy, drive out demons. And I've noticed, it's interesting, isn't it, how, what's his name, Robin Gamble, he's a Church of England vicar who's done this course called Leading a Church into Growth. And he says that Jesus had a PhD in preaching healing and deliverance. I like that, isn't it? Preaching healing and deliverance. And it's interesting where we spend our time on those different things. If you've ever gone to Bible college or trained in any ministry, you spend a lot of time learning how to preach, lots of time, lectures, videos. Maybe do a little bit on healing, but hardly any on deliverance. Whereas actually, in the scriptures, it's the opposite way around. If you look in Mark's gospel in particular, lots about the demons, a little bit about healing, and less about preaching. And I've noticed that I think that that trauma can be a landing pad for evil. It can be also be a place for God's grace, but it can also be a landing pad for evil. And I've noticed that Jesus, he doesn't beat around the bush. He speaks about this. Whereas in our culture, we've got into this bind. It's either it's something really scary, so either The Exorcist or there's a new Omen film out at the moment, this scary world, or this kind of fantasy make-believe world. And it's neither. Neither is true. Somewhere in the middle. Anthony of Egypt, who was one of my heroes of faith, he went out into the desert of Egypt in the 3rd century. And we have the most manuscripts about his life outside the New Testament, so he was really important in that sense. He's got this lovely phrase about the demons. He says this: "Even if they attack us and appear to threaten death, they ought to be laughed at rather than feared, for they are weak and cannot carry out all their threats." So within that context, let me give you two examples of what I mean by God's heart surgery. The first example is on a big scale. Sometimes it's easier to follow things on a big scale. I came across this story a little bit by accident, and it was about a doctor called Alexander McCall, and he was trained in Edinburgh, went out as a medical missionary to China in the 1950s and 60s, and a very scientific training like me, and then suddenly encountered this world of kind of witchcraft and spirits and realized that he needed not just to operate on a horizontal plane, he needed to operate on a vertical plane too. And he tells this really moving story about the Bermuda Triangle. And if you know the story of the Bermuda Triangle, me and my brother used to be really excited by this when we were growing up, this triangle in the west of the West Indies where ships and planes seem to mysteriously disappear. And he tells, this is his story. So for hundreds of years, the Bermuda Triangle has swallowed up ships and aircrafts, often without trace. And I scoffed at such irrational fears. But in 1972, my wife and I were sailing through the Triangle on a banana boat. We were caught in a Force 9 storm. The ship's boilers broke. And my wife and I, in the quietness, distinctly heard a strange sound, like a steady droning dirge. Almost 2 million slaves were thrown overboard into the sea at this point, and it occurred to us that we'd heard this mournful dirge for a purpose. Perhaps we had a responsibility to pray for those slaves who died uncommitted to the Lord and to repent of the cruelty of those who were the cause of it. So basically, he got together some church leaders and bishops from each corner of the triangle. They celebrated a communion service and to sort of to release the untimely death and also to repent for what had been done to these people. And from that time of they call it the Jubilee Communion until now, there's been no accidents in the Bermuda Triangle. Do not underestimate the power of the blood of Jesus on the cross. Then the second way of it's a bit more of a personal story for me. So this is 2020, just before lockdown. We were meeting as a College of Bishops in Lambeth Palace. There's 120 bishops, and we were meeting across, Lambeth Palace is just across the River Thames from the House of Parliament. It's quite a swanky place. We were doing some tough stuff for 3 days about LLF. So the praying community there put together 3 hours of prayer, the different prayer stations based around Psalm 139. And one of the prayer rooms, which I avoided the whole way through, was this place, they called it the womb room. And in the end, I thought, oh gosh, I really felt prompted I had to go in there. And it was just a small room off a chapel. And they blacked it out and put a heartbeat sound and a red light. And it had this scripture that "You knit me together in my mother's womb. I praise you because I'm fearfully and wonderfully made." And as I just went into that room, I just burst into floods of tears. I didn't know why on earth that happened. So I went to see one of the chaplains. I said, no idea what's happened to me. I had a really happy childhood, except my mum didn't want me. And I thought, oh, I've never said that before. What a strange thing to say. So a couple of weeks later, I happened to be seeing my spiritual director. That's somebody who kind of coaches you spiritually. And I really recommend having somebody like that in your life. I told her the story again, burst into floods of tears again. And she said to me, "Jill, why don't you listen to the tears?" I thought, I don't listen to tears. I'm a scientist. I'm rational. I don't do that. Listen to the tears. So I listened to the tears. And in the silence, I heard this question, am I wanted? Am I wanted? And she prayed for me. And it was, I was literally almost like sick. And it felt like a really dark lie came out from that had been with me all my life. Leaving almost like this, like a massive gap. You know, when you've had a tooth out, you're left with a big gap in your gum. And she prayed for me, and she had this beautiful image of Jesus catching me as a newborn baby, you know, full of joy, like you would do with any baby. And she said, Jesus, would you fill Jill with your joy? And it felt like this cavity deep inside me was filled with this like massive amount of joy. My heart grew twice the size. In fact, the next day I was leading a quiet day for some trainee vicars. And they said, Bishop Jill, you're so full of joy. I didn't tell them the story, but I thought, I know I've had deep root heart surgery going on. But I would just want to just underline that story, because in some ways it sounds a bit brutal, but in my family, there'd been a history of girls not being wanted. In the 1930s, my gran had a baby, her first baby at home. He was breech birth and stillborn. Then they had my auntie, and then they had a last chance at having a boy, and they had my mum in late 30s. And if you met, and unbelievably, that my mum knows that when my grandfather saw her, he looked away in disappointment. And if you met her, my mum, she had the word disappointment over her forehead. And so it sounds sexist, doesn't it, that they wanted a boy, but I think that came out of grief. But somehow, unbeknownst to me, that I travelled down, that it wasn't the best thing to be a girl, which is obviously a complete lie. And I think there can be places of trauma that can be a landing pad for evil. And the four most common things I spot round about are fear, rejection, death, and imposter syndrome. All those things are quite normal, so I'm not over-spiritualizing things in some ways. Who's not afraid? When we cross the road, it's good to be afraid in case you get run over by a bus. But Martin Luther said this. He said, you can't stop the birds flying over your head, but you can stop them nesting in your hair. You can't stop fear flying over your head, but you can stop it nesting in your hair. And I believe that some people end up living with high levels of all these things, fear, rejection, death, and imposter syndrome. And I think Jesus can literally hoover up. He can bind the darkness in us. This is Matthew 16, verse 18. He gave to Peter the keys to the kingdom of heaven to bind and to loose. And just notice those things in you. Because I think Jesus gently does, I call it heart surgery. He's like the surgeon of our souls, and he can gradually unravel the knitting of our lives and withdraw some of the sharp, almost like splinters of pain and trauma. And that actually allows an even bigger well of grace, room for his grace. I see the kingdom of God moving forward mostly in places where there's a lot of pain. It's almost opposite to what you think. Because if people there are humble enough to turn to him, he excavates that pain and he allows chambers for his grace that would not otherwise have happened. And maybe that's part of your story too. And I want to say this ever so tenderly. Maybe there's been serial pain as part of your story. Actually, under his mercy, through the power of what he did on the cross, those places can be places of his extraordinary grace. Do not despair. In other ways, I believe he can redeem these moments in ways you could never possibly imagine. And finally, we've had God's heart is breaking, God's heart surgery, and then finally God's heart for forward. I love that you speak so often about the Fullwood family. You know, our nation, people are looking for family, aren't they? And I think there's a beautiful one here. I spoke at the beginning about this open heaven. Isn't it interesting? In the pictures, it's hard to imagine what God looks like, but in the glimpses we have of him in Scripture, so Ezekiel and Revelation, he's often portrayed as having this fiery torso, like a heart of fire, literally. And that's my prayer for you today. In all that you carry as Fullwood Free Methodists, may you carry that incredible fire that's not to go back to 200 years ago, but actually to propel you forward, to carry that fire from the heart of God to reach people in Fullwood and beyond with the fiery love that is in the heart of God. He's longing for them to come home. Fire refines. The beautiful thing about the Holy Spirit is he can cauterize our wounds. That's another word for it, what I was talking about before. He can come into those dark places where it seems that evil has got the better words, and he can bring his healing and his grace. That's what we've just experienced last weekend with Easter, the most earth-shattering news in the history of the universe, that darkness does not have the last word. And he is able. He is more than willing. And he will defy the darkness. So, Fulwood family, may you see the horses and chariots of fire surrounding you. May you carry that fire from the heart of God into the places where you live, where you work, where you serve. And maybe for you, if it's the first time you've encountered the sense that his fiery love is for you, he's not in judgment over you, but he loves you and wants you to come home. May you know that afresh, or even for the first time, that love in his heart. And maybe if you're despairing that you're living under high levels of fear, or rejection, or death, or imposter syndrome, may those be the very places where his fire comes in ways that you never possibly imagined, to cauterize your wounds and to enable you to be a channel of his grace in ways you could not possibly understand. I'm going to invite the vans to come up, but I also want to just take you to that sense that one day, this is my prayer, and I'm speaking this in faith over you, in one day we'll meet again before the throne of Jesus. And may out of the Fulwood family, you find that you have a bigger family. You have children, grandchildren, great-grandchildren, born in impossible circumstances, but like the Paddington film, who you never realized you'd almost given birth to. Because of your faith, because of your fiery faith, may there be an amazing throng before the throne of heaven. Come, Holy Spirit. Would you move and minister to my dear family today? Jesus, where there's high levels, particularly fear, Jesus, I ask that you would bind that and send it to the place you appointed. Bring your peace, your courage from heaven. Pray for those who don't realize that there has a special home, a special fiery love in the heart of the Father. May you see him. May you know his tender touch on your wounds. May you hear him calling you home. And Fulwood Free family, may you stand on the shoulders of giants. May you carry his fire. And we claim Preston, we claim Fulwood in the name of Jesus. The King of Kings, Lord of Lords. Amen.
In the darkness, we were waiting without hope, without life, to the heaven you came.
the morning that you rose, all of heaven held its breath, till the stone was moved for good, for the Lamb had conquered death. And the dead rose from their tombs, and the angels stood in awe, for the souls of all who come to the Father are restored. And the church of Christ was born, then the Spirit lit the flame. Now this gospel truth of all shall unveil, shall unflame. By His blood and in His name, in His freedom I am free. For the love of Jesus Christ was resurrected me.
Yours be the glory, Father.
Lord Jesus Christ.
started off the service this morning asking, do we have an ear to hear what the Spirit of God is saying to the church? And I believe the Spirit of God spoke to my heart personally through that message this morning. I want to say thank you, Jill, for your personal application, for your transparency in what you shared this morning. And Jill spoke about people who are coming home to the Father to find peace again in your heart. And there's maybe people here who haven't got peace, don't have the peace of God because they don't have peace with God. And I believe that we want to give you an opportunity this morning. Maybe you're going to pray this prayer for the first time, just to acknowledge God and Jesus as the Lord and Savior of your life, and to find peace with God. I'm going to pray a very simple prayer, and with every head bowed, if you want to pray this prayer and you want to say, God, I want to surrender my life to you. I want to come home to the family of God. Home at last. I want my heart to abide in, at peace with God. Just pray this simple prayer in the quietness of your own heart after me. Lord Jesus, I repent of my sin. Come into my heart. I make you my Lord and my Savior. Amen. Amen. And if you've prayed that prayer maybe for the first time this morning, I want to say congratulations. We believe you've stepped over a line and stepped into the family of God. And you can receive that love and that healing. And if you want prayer afterwards, because Jill spoke about trauma and she spoke about some very painful things that sometimes have stepped into our lives. And we have a prayer team here. And when I've prayed a blessing to conclude our service this morning and people go out for teas and coffees, maybe you want some prayer. We have a prayer team, people with purple lanyards. If you want to come forward and just take a seat on the front row, we will have pastors and we'll have prayer ministry for you. We'll be able to stand with you and pray through some of those difficult things that you feel the Spirit of God has spoken to you this morning. Allow me to pray a prayer of blessing as we conclude our service. This morning, this is a well-known blessing that God told Moses to speak over the people of God. And he says this, the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face towards you and give you peace. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
are here, touching every heart. I worship you. I worship you. You are here, healing every heart. I worship you. Oh, I worship you. You are here, turning lives around. I worship you. I worship you. You are here, and you mend in every heart. I worship you. I worship you. You are.